Hello everyone. Welcome to the chapter 19 of the Business Correspondent and Business Facilitator course of Indian Institute of Banking and Finance. The course name of course is called as Inclusive Banking Through Business Correspondence. So in this chapter we will be covering the central and state government schemes. There are many central and state government schemes which have been recently introduced by the Prime Minister. But what we will be doing in the coming slides is that we will try to take the key ones, and also the key features of each of the schemes will be covered in this particular session. So to begin with, the government schemes, these are being classified as central, state, and jointly with central and state. So this is how the classification of government schemes have been done. The central schemes are further classified into two portions, that is the central sector schemes and the centrally sponsored schemes. So this is simply because they wanted to identify or categorize the schemes which will be 100% funded by the union government. And in the centrally sponsored scheme, they were trying to see that there is a partial funding from the central government and there is a partial funding from the state government. So therefore, jointly, both of them would be funding towards that scheme, and for which is for the welfare of the people. Now, in the first part, central sector schemes, we can see that 100% is funded by the union government, and it is, however, implemented by the central government. And an example of this is the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. The centrally sponsored scheme is, as I have said earlier, that there is some percent of funding which is borne by states. Now this can be decided in whatever ratio, which is normally generally here 50-50, 70-30, 75-25 or 90-10. The first 50 or the first ratio which we are talking pertains to the center, and the second one that we are talking is pertaining to the state. So if we take this example, that means we are trying to say that 75% will be funded by the center and 25% of that fund value will be funded by the state government. However, if this is under this scheme, then the implementation is by that respective state. And I've just given an example here. The Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana is a centrally sponsored scheme, is one of the centrally sponsored schemes. Coming to this, one of these key ones, which are one of the key schemes which has been introduced by the government, is the Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana, National Rural Livelihoods Mission. The short form for this is DAY-NRLM. Now this was basically introduced to reduce poverty in India. Now how do we reduce this poverty? There is some funds which have been already earmarked towards this mission. And for each of the states, the funds will get earmarked basis the poverty level. Not that if there is 100 rupees which is being allocated towards this mission, not that 100 rupees will go towards, or let's say 50 rupees will go towards one state only, or 20 rupees. Depending on the poverty level of, let's say, state A, state B, state C, depending on that, these funds will be utilized by the states. So as I already said, that this is a CSS one. CSS, as we already know, is a centrally sponsored scheme. So therefore, there is a sharing on the funding by the center, between the center and the state. So this, how does it happen, is what we are seeing. It is in the ratio of 75:25. But if it is, let's say, pertaining to any northeastern states, then 90% of the fund will be given by the center and 10% of the fund will be given by the state. And for union territories, 100% by the center. So how are we going to be covering these, or how are we going to be reducing poverty? The target was that you should be covering 100% of the BPL families. When we say BPL, meaning below poverty line families. So how will this also happen? All this is being laid down, okay? So they are saying that 50%, if you have to cover 100% of the BPL families, this should comprise of 50% of the scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, 15% minorities, and 3% disabled persons. That means whomsoever you are trying to cover and they fall under the BPL family, there should be a composition at least of 50% scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, 15% minorities, and 3% of disabled persons. But how do you think this is all going to be achieved? This has also been laid down in the scheme. What they are suggesting is that at least one member from the household, preferably a woman, should be called in to the SHG. SHG is nothing but the self-help group. Now, from there, what they will do is, once they have tried to rope in all the women, at least the women from each of the household, they will try to then bring all the men and also these women together to discuss some very basic issues that each one of them are facing. That is, like, they will try to bring in under the weavers associations. So many aspects will be discussed in this forum. Like, how do we actually do funding? What is the kind of money that is being done? What are the benefits that will be given? So when that discussion happens in an open forum, automatically you try to get them all included. So because of this, they feel that in this kind of discussions, you get motivated. When it is not self-motivation that can be done, then you use the help of a group to actually boost the livelihood by saying that this is what is available to you, or probably some person would actually share his experience and say that, no, see, I have actually been benefited by doing such a thing. And in this way, the others get motivated and the poor gets included. So this is what is the process they have used to ensure that everybody tries to come under this scheme. So therefore, you can see that there is both a demand side as well as a supply side. Now, what do we mean by this? We see that the financial literacy is getting promoted amongst the poor. Also, an initial capital is given to the self-help groups, and that is given through a revolving fund. We will see subsequently what does this revolving fund mean. So a capital is also given to this self-help groups by which they can start out with some kind of activity. They are also being given how do you use this money. That is where the financial literacy comes into picture. And in the supply side, because this is already the basic thing is given to them, then there is also the supply which is coming from the government, which says that you please use these technologies which are available, which is helping you in quicker and faster processing. So they are encouraging this use. And they are also saying, in addition, if you are not too comfortable, we have business correspondents whom we have trained them in these aspects. So therefore, you take their assistance. So this is what is there in this scheme. So we see that these are the positives of this scheme. So what is this revolving fund? Revolving fund, as I told you, that is an initial capital that the government is actually giving to this self-help groups. Now, why is this given? Definitely, it is to build good credit history and to strengthen their capacity. Why should they be given? Or why do you think you should? Because unless and until they are the weaker sections of the society, they don't have any money. So how do we actually boost them? So to strengthen them and to make them feel very confident, there is this fund which is being made available by the government. But who is eligible? And that is where we are saying that the amount is minimum 10,000 they will give and maximum 15,000 per SHG is what is being allotted in under this scheme. Now, who are eligible for this scheme? SHGs who have been in existence for a minimum of 3 to 6 months. Suppose they have opened an SHG and that has successfully operated for 3 to 6 months, they can take this facility. They should not have taken this revolving fund earlier. It's available only once. If this has already been taken earlier, they cannot avail of this facility again. And very importantly, these SHGs have got something to be followed, which is called as the Panchasutra. What is this Panchasutra? It is that they are they are trying to be very disciplined. They are a disciplined SHG. They have regular meetings, they have regular savings, they lend internally, that is, they help each other, whoever is there in the self-help group, they help the members of the self-help groups. Then they try to see that the recoveries are also regular, there is no default. And they are also maintaining proper books of accounts. There is no fraud. There is nothing very intentionally that they want to carry out any unfair means. So they are a very disciplined SHG. Of course, this is been written to ensure that the money is really actually going in to the proper hands, and they are going to be making a fruitful utilization of these funds. That is why this is what has been said, laid down. Now, coming to the very next important scheme again, is the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin. When we say Awas, Awas means your house, where you are going to be staying. So therefore, everybody should be actually having a proper house to live in. There has to be a proper shelter. This is a basic need of a man. So this was actually restructured in April 2016, which was earlier called as the Indira Awas Yojana. In this, what has happened in this particular Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin, they have tried to ensure that you get a pakka house, and there is a house for everybody. There is not a single one who's left out without no house. And that ensuring will be done by 2022. When we say pakka, pakka in Hindi, pakka is a word in Hindi. So pakka means that it is a good house. It is a very robust house. It is not going to be falling off very easily due to natural calamities. So that is where I had said the pakka house, meaning that it can withstand climatic conditions and you can also maintain it for a long term. That is, at least for about 30 years, you can have a reasonable maintenance time. But though the scheme is being given, there are some restrictions. The government says it is not going to be available to everyone. So who are the beneficiaries who can be included in this? They are saying that the female-headed households, that means a household which has a female or it has a single girl child, households without shelter who just don't have anything, who are beggars, who are living on alms, that means they are actually begging and they are having their livelihood. And then these garbage pickers, or you can say rag pickers, you know, I should be calling them as more as rag pickers, because they are the ones who really don't, they are earning their daily livelihood by actually picking up the dirt and then putting it into the respective garbage where they have to be doing. And the highly interior rural areas wherein you will have the tribal groups. So these are the beneficiaries who are to be included under this scheme. This is also another scheme, as we had already said, this is a centrally sponsored scheme wherein the center and state will be sharing the ratio of the, will be funding this particular scheme, and it will be done in plain areas, it will be done in the ratio of 60:40, and in hilly areas and other difficult areas like northeastern states, which are very difficult, you will be doing it in the ratio of 90:10. So 10 will be from the state and 90 from the central government. So now coming to what kind of assistance, some additional features of this particular scheme. There is an assistance given, a financial assistance of about 1.2 lakhs in the plain areas and 1.3 lakhs in the hilly areas. Toilets are also being provided for with a funding of about 12,000 rupees. Now, when they are going to be constructing the house, definitely you need to know how much is the minimum at least that you can actually be doing. It is just 25 square meters. So they are saying this has to be at least the minimum minimum measurement of the house by which a minimum measurement by on which a house can be constructed. They have also set up a national technical support agency. This agency is going to be providing the technical assistance in the construction of the house. And after you construct the house, it's just not that you just give them four walls and you say, yes, the job is over. This is also to ensure that basic amenities, like whatever you require, like electricity, the LPG connection, the gas connection, the drinking water, the piped drinking water. Otherwise, you can go and pick up drinking water. But the piped drinking water, all these facilities are also suitably made in that house, wherein a person can come and comfortably live in that house. And very important thing they have said is, if it has already been sanctioned for that particular place, then the construction should be completed within 12 months from the sanction date. This is the earlier one which we saw was the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana for Grameen, that is for the villages. So similarly, they have also said definitely even in urban areas, you're going to have such kind of people living. So therefore, for the urban areas, a few points which has been listed down here. It is based on four objectives, that is the rehabilitation of slum dwellers. There is a lot of, in metro cities you will go to see, there is a lot of slum dwelling. So these people, how do we actually give them good houses? You try to build them for them, some good houses and some good flats, and then you try to rehabilitate them and shift them to these houses. So in this way, you are eradicating also this slum dwelling. You are giving a affordable housing for weaker section, and then trying to do affordable housing in partnership with public and private sectors. It's a subsidy for beneficiary-led individual house. So these are the four bases by which they are trying to implement this Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana on the urban areas. Over here, what would the beneficiary family be? It would be a family which has comprises of a husband, a wife, and unmarried sons and daughters, an adult member irrespective of the marital status, because as long as there is an adult member in that house, it's fine, and then they are not insisting that that person has to be married, and not owning a pakka house anywhere in India. He's not supposed to say he's having another house and here show that he does not have any and then claim this benefit. So this is as far as the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. Now, when there is this housing schemes, we have seen that housing schemes have been given in both the rural areas and the urban areas. But there is also, in addition to all this facility, the government is also giving some subsidy. Now, how does this subsidy work is what we will see under four categories. That is for the weaker sections, for the low income group, for the middle income group of one strata, and the middle income group of another strata, which will be there, which will be covered in the next slide. Now, coming to this, the weaker section and the low income group, the subsidy can be availed if the household income is 3 lakhs per annum for a weaker section, and if it is between 3 lakhs to 6 lakhs for a low income group. The loan amount for this subsidy is up to 6 lakhs you can take. But the subsidy interest or the subsidy that is the subsidy that can be availed of is 6.5% for a loan tenure of 20 years. Now suppose if you have availed for 6 lakhs and the loan has been taken for 20 years, you will be getting a 6.5%. But suppose, let's say you have taken 6 lakhs, but you have taken a loan for only up to 15 years, then also 6.5% only will be given, but for 15 years only. So that is where we say, or up to tenure taken, whichever is lower. That time it will not be a loan up to 20 years. So whatever tenure loan you have taken, only up to that period, and for that amount that you have taken, you will be getting a interest subsidy of 6.5%. And they have given the cap amount for this subsidy. They are saying if you are falling under the weaker section, then it will not be more than 267,280. This is the max that you can get. And if it is you are in the low income group, not more than 267,280. The same amount remains. The carpet area here has been defined. If you are falling under economically weaker section, it is only 30 square meters. And low income group, 60 square meters. And for all this, they are having a nodal agency, which is the National Housing Board, as well as the HUDCO, which is the Housing and Urban Development Corporation. Now coming to the next group, which we were wanting to tell you. That is the middle income group. They have classified the middle income groups into two sections. That is one who has an household income of 6 to 12 lakhs, and the middle income group, which is another group, which is having a annual household income of 12 to 18 lakhs. So here again, the subsidy amount or the loan amount which is eligible is 9 lakhs and 12 lakhs. And the interest subsidy here, if you see, here there are changes. It is 4% under the group 1 and 3% under the group 2. Subsidy amount also changes, 235,068. This is the cap that you have. And under the group 2, it is 230,156. And the carpet area here is 90 square meters. And for this carpet area, it is 110 square meters. So this is the subsidy in addition to what we have already discussed under the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, both for Gramin as well as for urban. This is in addition to that, they are getting this subsidy scheme provided you fall under all these things. So there are some certain certain conditions which they have listed out. If we have fallen, then we will be definitely getting this subsidy. Now, in addition to the schemes which have been readily available, there is something which the government has also introduced as the interest subvention scheme. Now, what is this? What do you mean by subvention? Subvention means wherein it is the particular expense is being shared. Now, in this case, because it is interest subvention, and because it's a scheme which is being offered by the government, it is said that there is part interest which is paid by the government. So suppose if you are being charged an interest of, let's say, 6%, and let's say the government is ready to give you is ready to part with 3% of this, means effectively you are only paying 3%, because government is already paying the 3% on that. Now, where is it all offered on? Presently, on what all schemes? They are saying it's on livelihoods, that is on that day NRLM which we saw. Short-term credit for crop loans, majorly for farmers, simply because they do face into not many natural calamities. Then there are loss of crops. So if they have taken a crop loan, they may not be able to repay it very easily. So therefore, definitely government says that I am going to consider that and also give him the benefit. Now, how will he be giving him that benefit? So if he is going to be, let's say, but if he is going to be making prompt payment, this is what we are saying. If he is going to be prompt payment, he is going to get an incentive of 3%. So if that 3% is extended, and let's say the bank has lent him at 7%, and he is a very standard repayer, in the sense he really repays the money on time, for whatever loan that he has availed of, his effective rate is therefore definitely reduced to 4%. He is not actually paying 7%. Whereas if they are affected by natural calamities, they are definitely not going to be able to repay the money. So therefore, how? The bank cannot be at a loss. So what the government says is, in such cases, 2% is what I will pay you, so that you also don't feel the loss of it. And you also can get time to restructure the crop loan which is there, and accordingly decide how much of it now you need to be taking from the farmer. Similarly, in rural housing also, we have got that it is under, so you're getting a subsidy of 3%. Crop loans, as I have told you, it is calculated on the amount. The subvention or the benefit is what I'm trying to say. The interest subvention is being calculated on the amount from the date of disbursement to the date of repayment. So this is how this scheme, interest subvention scheme, I have just given a general purview as to how this actually works and for different products and what is the need for it. The government has come ahead with many schemes. Of course, in the coming slides, I will not be detailing onto each of these schemes. A few important features is what will be looked into. To start with, it is the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. This is basically for people who, it's an unskilled labor work, okay? and it is guaranteeing you an employment of about 100 days. So therefore, an illiterate or an unskilled labor is also assured of some amount, some earning that he can have. And this was what was the requirement also in a way to bring the financially excluded people into the system so that they have some amount of money, and also to give them some benefits so that they have confidence in that they can be earning some money over here. It was launched on 2 February 2006. Then we have the next scheme, which is the Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. This was basically to provide connectivity to unconnected villages, wherein these villages should be having a population of at least 500 persons. So that also, if you're going to be providing connectivity, that village or to the village where you want accessibility of road, that village or that particular area should have a population of 500 persons, which is in plain areas, and 250 persons in other areas. This was a part of poverty reduction strategy. The next scheme, Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. From the very name, of course, it is Garib, meaning we are trying to uplift the poor only. So that is what we are trying to say. It is a poverty alleviation scheme, meaning you will give them some how exactly you can uplift the poor. Now, to uplift the poor, you need to be motivated, and to get them motivated, you need to know how you can effectively implement the schemes. Because if you don't explain the schemes or you don't effectively have them implemented on the ground, there is no use of it, because the poor are going to continue to remain poor. So therefore, to have them actually come out of the poverty, this one scheme was there. It was launched in April 2015. The members are actually appraised on how does this implementation happen on the field. So this is what is the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. The next one, Pradhan Mantri Jan Aushadhi Yojana. The very fact that we are understanding Aushadhi means medicines. So if we see, the names of the schemes are also very much related to the words or to the words that we use in day in and day out in our colloquial talks. So Aushadhi means medicines, so which means they were trying to provide medicines at affordable cost, and there are around 300 outlets are planned to be open, in which 500 medicines will be sold less than the market price. And this can be opened by private hospitals, NGOs, social groups who can open this. And there is a one-time assistance given by the government of about 2.5 lakhs. So this was launched in March 2016 to basically help the poor to get themselves treated, so that, and that too at a reasonable cost, rather than charging very exorbitant prices for some simple drug that they need to be taking. Then coming to the next one, we are having the Pradhan Mantri Ujjwala Yojana. This was launched on May 1, 2016. It was basically to distribute free LPG connections to the BPL families. So because rather than having difficulty in actually cooking in a chula, then they try to ensure at least let us give them some benefit wherein they start cooking through a free gas connections, and that will also help them from many other health issues that are being faced. And for this, the government decided a financial support of rupees 600 for each LPG gas connection will be given. Another scheme which the government came out with is Deen Dayal Upadhyaya Gram Jyoti Yojana. It was basically to ensure that all villages have electricity 24/7, and everybody has electricity without any difficulty. And the nodal agency for this is the Rural Electrification Company, and this is of course a scheme for rural electrification, as the name goes. Another scheme which under the Prime Minister which got launched was the Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana. This was launched in July 2015. This was basically to help the farmers. So what is it? they were trying to see the extent of irrigation that can be covered. When we say irrigation, meaning in very simple words, har khet ko pani. In a sense, everywhere there should be water that should be available, so that in every agricultural land, the water should be available so that there can be easily agricultural irrigation easily carried out. And also water use efficiency. The importance of water is also to be sensitized over here. So therefore, to tell them with this caption saying that more crop per drop. Har pani ke saath, har boond pani ke saath, aur badhai aayegi. Now coming to this will also promote micro irrigation, like sprinklers, like what all kind of equipments you can use to actually get this effective irrigation. So you can use sprinklers, you can use rain guns, drips, and this will also save the extent of water. It will give you that enough quantity of water, adequate quantity of water that the crops require, but also the extra wastage is also reduced. And plus it will also reduce the use of fertilizers. So this was one more scheme which got launched under the Pradhan Mantri Yojanas. Another one, Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana, which was launched in April 2015. A new institution was set up called as the Mudra, that is Micro Units Development and Refinance Agency Limited. It was basically set up to provide finance to units whose credit needs are below 10 lakhs. This is for somebody who wants to start up a unit, but they don't have money and their requirement is also very less. They don't have a very high requirement of things. So three kind of loan products they decided to give in this: Shishu, which will be up to an amount of rupees 50,000. Kishore, which will be greater than 50,000 to up to 5 lakhs. And Tarun loan, which will be greater than 5 lakhs but up to 10 lakhs. So this is all done to be facilitating different sections of the society, if we see. Now we see what recently we have seen a lot many campaigns which are being happening. So that is like a Make in India campaign, which was to basically transform India into a manufacturing hub. It was launched in September 2014. And this lion is actually symbolizing strength, and it is also symbolizing national pride. So therefore, this was used as a symbol. Startup India or Stand Up India, it was to boost entrepreneurship, because every small person or a new young youth would like to actually carry out his business. He may be having ideas. So therefore, to boost entrepreneurship, it was launched in August 2015. Skill India, to train every person in India in different skills by 2022. So this was launched in July 2015. And of course, Digital India, to ensure that every urban and rural area is provided online services. So this is how some of the campaigns have recently which have been launched. There are more to go, but then these are some of the key ones which have been covered over here. So this entire session, I have tried to bring out the key features, and I hope this has been really helpful to you all. Trying to bring out all the central and state government schemes. State government, of course, the each state will try to carry out its own scheme and implement it. So I hope this session was of really some good insight, and trying to bring out these key points, if one remembers what it is actually relevant to, will really be helpful. Thank you very much.